be an actor is you got to be crazy. So you got to not be afraid to try anything. So I figured, what the hell? If I'm in for a penny, I'm in for a pound.
Yeah.
So I attended everything. I never missed. A lot of people would come one day a week or something. I went there every day. And I just figured I'd just keep going. Then I'd go out and watch other groups or study with other groups in the evening. So eventually you get a kind of an idea of what it is that teaches you how to act. And you never really know it till you feel it. One day you feel it and you sort of say, yeah, now I think I'm on the road to something. But because you're not using an instrument like a saxophone or any kind of musical instrument where you're playing through something and you're using yourself, you never really know what the instrument's doing. You just only feel a certain emotion that gives it to you, and there you are as a person. You don't know it's you're acting or what's happening until eventually it kicks in, you know, that people start responding to it.
Yeah. In our school, we call that breakthrough. Precisely that. How long were you there at university?
I was there a year and a half.
What happened?
Second year, they said, well, we don't want to keep you around anymore. To give you a raise, my salary went up over $100 a week. So they said, but if you'll stay at the same rate, we'll keep you another 6 months. So I did that. I stayed at the same rate. And then finally, after 6 months, they kind of gave me the old. And I went out there.
You were getting too expensive for them.
Very expensive, very expensive. I went out into the cold world of television.
How long were you on Rawhide?
I started the pilot, I think it was 58. I got to, was it out there until 65?
7 years?
Yeah.
And you've said you learned a lot on that.
Yeah, I did. Everybody used to be nuts about doing a series. They always thought, well, it locks you down. It inhibits you. I found nothing inhibiting about it. I thought it's a great learning ground. You can screw up every day and still have a chance to redeem yourself because you can experiment on film all the time.
During this time when you were on Rawhide, something happened. From 1964 to 1966, a lot of things changed with the three Sergio Leone Westerns. For you and for the traditional Western form, which had previously been America's exclusive province, how did A Fistful of Dollars come to you?
Well, I was going into a hiatus on Rawhide, a three-month layoff, and they said, well, we've got this Western we want to make in Europe, Italian company, made in Spain, German co-production, about a $200,000 budget. And I said, I don't think so. You know, I'd really like to just take the time off. I've got a job, and I'm coming back to a job in a few months. And then the guy said, well, I promised the Rome office that you'd read it. And I read it, and I read it. I recognized it right away as Yojimbo. So I thought, well, Yojimbo, that was great. I love that movie. It was a conscious adaptation of Yojimbo, though the Italians neglected to tell the Japanese that they were doing this.
How much input did you have in the look and sound of that character?
Sergio Leone didn't speak any English, and I didn't speak any Italian, so I was kind of on my own.
Where did you get your wardrobe?
Well, I brought it. I brought it from this country.
Did you?
I went and picked out a bunch of stuff.
Where'd you get the little cigars?
I got them in Beverly Hills.
Beverly Hills?
Yeah. They were Beverly Hills cigar. They had a cigar called a Virginia cigar. It was long and had a big stem through it. And I just bought them and cut them up in three pieces and used them like that. So I made a whole box of them last the length of the picture.
One of the most striking elements of your character in that film was his laconic speech. Was that simply part of the script, or did you develop that style?
I kind of developed that. I enjoyed the listening aspect more than I did the speaking aspect of the procedure anyway. So I was a person who observed everything that was going on around him.
Right.
So I figured the more he talked, the more he dissipated the strength of the character. So I opted for very little dialogue.
And created an unforgettable character. The film and its two sequels broke any number of rules. One of them being that in motion pictures, characters usually have names. What was your character's name?
Joe.
But he was never called Joe.
No, it was just Joe for the script. They just didn't call him anything.
He was the man with no name.
Yeah, he was the man with no name. That was a United Artists thing. In Italy, it was called Per un pugno di dollari. We made it under the title of Magnifico Straniero, which is a magnificent stranger. Some guy at United Artists had the brilliant concept of making it the man with no name. And I had star billing on the in the credits, and they came and asked me to waive that because they wanted to do just present the picture. And I was just a television actor at that time. So I did. I said, yeah, okay, I'll go along with that.
This man who was just a television actor became an instant, massive, international star and began a radically new Western mythos with that film. When Eli Wallach was a guest on this series, we talked about the good, the bad, and the ugly. And we were together in an actor's studio board meeting a couple of weeks ago. He sent you his very warmest wishes.
Yeah.
Eli Wallach has spoken of his admiration for your calmness as an actor. And you've said, I played the character down while everyone else was operatic.
Eli was playing this sort of frantic Latino.
Yeah.
And we worked well together. And it was great fun.
One of the fundamental principles of the Western that was demolished by this trilogy was the pure black and white structure of the good guy and the bad guy. Your character was, I think, the first movie character, really, who didn't wait for the other guy to draw his gun.
Yeah.
You shot first.
Yeah, well, it doesn't make sense. Why would you wait for somebody to draw his gun? American Westerns, I never could understand that. And I remember Don Siegel got in trouble when he was doing a film called The Shootist some years later, and he was working with John Wayne. The villain sneaks around the room, and John Wayne comes up behind him, and he says, "Then just shoot him." And he said, there was a long pause, and he said, John Wayne said, "You mean I shoot him in the back?" And he says, yeah, you shoot him, just shoot him, get rid of him, because you got four other guys. And he says, I don't shoot anyone in the back. And Don made a terrible error. He said, Clint Eastwood would have shot him in the back. And he said, Wayne turned blue, you see. And he said, I don't care what that kid would have done, I don't shoot him in the back.
One of the most famous scenes in the film, deservedly, is what I suspect is the longest face-off in Western movie history. It's going to close-ups of the eyes, your eyes.
Yeah.
And Van Cleef's eyes.
Yeah.
And Eli's eyes.
Yeah.
In the course of shooting the trilogy, did you realize that it might have considerably more importance than you or anyone else had anticipated?
The first one I wasn't sure would do any business. I thought it would either do okay or would just do zero. And then all of a sudden, some weeks later, I read in the trades, a Variety or Reporter, one of them, that this picture, Per un pugno di dollari, is doing sensational business. Well, I didn't think anything of it because I had made a film called Magnifico Straniero. And then all of a sudden, some weeks later, they started reporting more on it. And finally, they said, for a Fistful of Dollars, starring Clint Eastwood. And I said, Clint Eastwood? And then all of a sudden, the call started coming in to my agency and saying, well, could he come over and do more, and would he do this and do that? So things started perking up a little after that, and it started becoming fun.
And when they perked up, you chose a very interesting role in a very interesting movie called Hang 'Em High, Hang 'em High was a co-production. What were the companies?
Well, Malpasso, which is my company.
Why did you form your own production company?
I wanted to do these smaller films, and I felt that I could control my destiny a little bit by maybe looking up some pieces of material that other people had overlooked or were not interested in, and maybe I could have some effect by getting them produced.
Where'd you get the name Malpasso?
From a piece of property on the Big Sur coast.
Where you were living?
Yeah. And Malpasso means bad pass or bad step in Spanish, and I'm not superstitious. So.
One of the purposes of this evening is to trace the evolution of a film director. Who directed you in Coogan's Bluff?
Don Siegel, yeah.
Didn't Mark Rydell recommend him highly?
Yeah, Mark Rydell. Well, I talked to Mark Rydell about possibly directing this film, and Mark says I couldn't prepare it in a month. He said, who else are you talking to? And I said, well, the studio's hung up on a guy named Don Siegel. He said, couldn't do better. He said, Don Siegel, I've worked for him as an actor. He says, Don Siegel is the only guy I can think of who could prepare in 1 month and be ready to roll. So I said, okay, what the hell, I'll go with Don Siegel.
You would wind up doing 5 films with Siegel. Obviously, you were impressed with his work on Coogan's Bluff. On Beguiled, which is, I think, a wonderful movie, you directed a documentary. What was that documentary?
Well, it was a documentary on Don and his participation. Beguiled was an interesting film because Don had never made a film like this. Well, I hadn't either. It was a very, very bizarre kind of book.
You played McBurney with your usual conviction. As the actor, how do you justify yourself to the character's worst traits? McBurney's not a very nice guy.
I didn't think he was so bad. He was a guy who was trying to survive. He gets taken into a girls' school in the South. He's a Southern soldier. And he starts manipulating them, and they start manipulating him. And it's sort of a mutual manipulation society.
Right.
But they eventually, it all goes bad. And he ends up dead.
I think the scene in which you wake up and find that your leg has been needlessly amputated is one of the best scenes you've done to that point.
I know my legs are all right. I can feel them all the way down to my toes.
Yes, it has to be.
Oh.
But you're too intelligent not to understand.
You dirty bitch. Just because I didn't go to your bed. Just because I went to someone else's bed.
I should have let you die screaming.
Why should I have denied myself after all I'd been through? You want to be so much the goddamn lady. The virgin bitch. Get out of here. Get out of here.
Who sang the song on the track as your body was carried out by the vengeful girls?
I think I did that.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did.
It was in my Rex Harrison best. Sort of a talk song.
In 1971, while you were receiving a Golden Globe and appearing on the cover of Life magazine as the world's top movie star, Beguiled opened to enormous popular success in Europe, with many critics hailing it as a great film. When you're considering any project, as actor or director, what makes you say, I'll devote the next year or two of my life to this?
Do I like it?
Just that, simple
as
that.
Yeah. I mean, I read the story, whether it's in the book form, script form or whatever, and I say, do I like this? Would I like to see this? If the answer is yes, and there's a role in there that is interesting for me, would I like to be in it? If the answer is yes, then I move to the next stage.
How did you make that important leap in 1971 to directing a movie, Play Misty for Me?
Well, thank you. Obviously a very sensitive audience. A friend of mine wrote the story, a girl who I used to know was a legal secretary who sent me this a 60-page treatment of this story. And I saw a lot of things in there that there's something about that. The stalker mentality is very popular nowadays, stalker mentality,
yes,
and what have you. And, and the picture's been ripped off two or three times in various forms.
In your first film as director, you began what would become a hallmark of your style, the significant use of music. Misty is a song, right? Mm-hmm. The Errol Garner record. And then we heard First Time Ever I Saw Your Face, which became a hugely popular song.
Did
you pick that music, or did it?
Yeah, I picked that music. It was originally written as Play Misty for me. Universal wanted to change it to Play Strangers in the Night for Me or something, because they owned the music to it. I said, no, you can't do that. And they said, you could call it Play Scooby Dooby Doo for me. Anyway, these were the kind of suggestions you got along the way that were always very exciting. I finally held out, and we bought Misty for $25,000, the rights to use it, and for the film, which was rather expensive considering the whole film was about a $720,000 movie.
This was your first directorial job. Did you bring it in on budget?
I brought it in on budget, under budget a little bit. It was a funny thing. I went into Lou Wasserman, who was the head of Universal at the time, and said, how about me making this picture? It's a little picture, and I want to direct it. And he sat there and looked at me, and he said, okay. I said, God, that's easy. And I was with my agent, Leonard Hirshan, and I said, geez, this is great. I get up, and I'm all, nice to see you, Mr. Wasserman. I head down the hallway, and he goes, Lenny, come back here, I want to talk to you. So they go in the other room, and then Lenny comes out and says, yeah, he wants to, he can let you do it. I said, it's terrific. He says, he doesn't want to pay you. And I said, well, you know something, he's right. Let me show what I can do, and then I'll show him that he was right to have faith in me.
One of the characteristics of the career that we're examining tonight is the way in which it continually rewrites the traditional rules and charts new territory. An obvious example of that is the series in which you created another movie icon who wasn't quite like anybody who had preceded him on the screen, Dirty Harry Callahan. How did Dirty Harry come into your life and ours?
It was Jennings Lang, an executive at Universal, said, I've got this script I'd like you to look at. He said, it's called Dirty Harry. He said, Paul Newman told me the other day, he said he really liked the script, but he didn't want to do it because it had political overtones he didn't like about it. And I said, really? I said, let me look at it. I don't know if this is true. I've never talked to Paul about it.
Yeah.
I said, well, let me look at it anyway. So I read it, and I really liked it. I thought it was great. I said, I'd do this.
The scene in which Clint delivers a tribute to the Magnum and utters the famous word, you got to ask yourself one question, do I feel lucky, set the thematic tone for the whole series, actually. Were you aware at that point that it would be picked up like that? It would become a catchword.
Well, I thought it was interesting that it showed the cop as being a guy with a somewhat devious sense of humor, I just thought, well, this is going to be an interesting character. It was during a time in history where people hadn't been giving a lot of attention to the victims of violent crime, and so I thought this is an interesting statement. Somebody who's absolutely obsessed about the well-being of a victim out there who he's never met, never will meet.
During those years, you did most of your own stunts, didn't you?
Well, a lot of them, yeah, unless it came to jumping off a 10-story building, I would probably opt for having someone else.
Who jumped from the bridge to the top of the school bus?
Oh, yeah, I did that.
Were you scared?
No, once you're in the character, you can do anything.
If our students don't take a note of that, they're missing out on what's
exactly. If you're really in the character, you can do that.
On several occasions in this series, notably with Steven Spielberg, with Ben Kingsley, we've talked about the virtue and use of silence in film. Don Siegel has said the hardest thing to do is nothing. A number of people have paid tribute to your expressive use of silence. What you're doing with me this moment is what you do so extraordinarily well. On the screen, you listen. Is it that important to you?
I think this most important thing, it's certainly the most important thing is in acting, is listening. Anybody can expound a lot of dialogue, but a lot of people don't listen well. In fact, I think it's something in life. My wife and I were talking about this the other night. Is one of the great things I think they ought to be teaching in schools, and not for acting, but for just life in general, is the art of listening. It's something that a lot of people don't understand, and a lot of people may listen or attempt to listen, but they don't hear, or they don't absorb what they're listening to. As acting students, we used to have to stand in front of the audience with your hands at your side, not in your pocket, and stand there and just be, and you're doing nothing, and you're going, okay. At first you're embarrassed about it, but after a while you just take a position about it, and you take an observation about it, and you look at people and regard things around you, and it's amazing the feeling it comes over you when you master it to the point where you're not inhibited from any outside effects, or you're not worried about what he or she out there is thinking about you. A lot of actors nowadays feel they have to do more. In the 50s, when I first started acting, the Actors Studio was coming into prominence, but from the group theater. Marlon was the big guy on the scene at that time. So everyone was trying to act like Marlon. And it was embarrassing because guys would be playing neurosurgeons and they'd be talking like this, you know. I just saw this guy's head up. But because every actor wanted to be him. And they didn't realize that he was playing a character of this fighter, punch drunk fighter, and it was a brilliant job.
With High Plains Drifter, you directed your first Western. What drew you to that project?
I liked the fact that the allegorical quality of it. It had you weren't sure. Actually, you were sure as it was written. You knew it was the guy who comes back was the brother of the murdered sheriff. That was the thing. But I'd made it very ambiguous so the audience could draw in their own conclusions to it. Was this some sort of mythical deal? Was this some sort of apparition?
You were working with Bruce Surtees, a great DP. How do you work with your DP? When does he enter the picture, literally and figuratively?
Bruce was kind of a funny guy. He didn't like to know too much. He kind of liked to shoot from the hip. But so I'd tell him how I saw the look. And sometimes I'd show him pictures. I'd show him pictures out of magazines or art books or something. I said, this is a look I like, this look here, how to get this, how to do that. And so we kind of made it up as we went.
How involved are you in the selection of the setup and the lens?
In those days, I would look through the lens, and sometimes we used variable lenses. In recent years, I've tended to go back to fixed lenses more, because the fixed lenses seem to have less problem. They seem to have a clarity that you can't quite get from a variable lens. If you're using anamorphic, for instance, I use predominantly a 50, 75, and 100, and maybe a 28. And those are probably the only four lenses I'd use the whole picture. The 50 would probably get the most action, and the 75 or 100 for close work.
And do you rehearse your actors before photography begins, ever?
I don't necessarily rehearse the actors and go through everything beforehand. No, we just kind of talk through scenes. Most of the time, just get out and do it. If you think about something long enough, you'll find a million reasons why not to do it. And I think if you get in and jump in feet first and just get boiling, and with certain actors you can do that, some you can't. I've worked with actors you can't. You have to rehearse, you have to run the scene. About number 6, 8, 10, they start really feeling pretty decent. And then other actors who want 6, 8, or 10, but the first one is the best. So you have to kind of feel, everybody's a little bit different.
This is the film in which the flat hat and a long frock coat make their appearance. Was that your choice?
Yeah.
How involved do you get in the appearance of each of your characters?
If it's a character, I get involved. If I'm directing the film, I get involved with the appearance of everyone.
What led you to the outlaw Josie Wales?
Let's It was interesting because it was the first Western that I'd ever read where Indians were not treated as just stoic.
In 1978, the highest grossing film of the year was Superman. Second highest grossing movie was Every Which Way But Loose. What persuaded you that the time had come to co-star with an orangutan?
Well, there's another insanity moment.
This
is the picture that nobody wanted to make. And everybody goes, God, you want who the hell? I mean, everybody, my business manager, my agent who's here tonight, everybody hated it. They said, this is the dumbest idea I've ever heard. And I said, yeah, it is, but I'm going to do it. So it's a challenge, and I like animals. And so what happened? Anyway, I thought it was funny. You know, I thought, and there was something kind of, even though it was a kind of an offbeat project, there was something kind of hip about it. I mean, the guy, he falls in love with a girl, and he gets dumped.
Yeah.
And he has to tell all his troubles to the orangutan.
It takes me a long time to get to know a girl. Even longer to let her know me. You know what I mean? Well, I'm not afraid of any man, but when it comes to sharing my feelings with a woman, my stomach just turns to royal jelly. I don't suppose that ever happens to you. Well, I guess you just keep howling until sometime they howl back, huh?
What's it like to work with an orangutan?
Very much like humans.
Now, he's Clyde in the movie, but his real name was Manus, wasn't it?
Manus, yeah. They're actually, because they're sort of a co-evolving, they are a co-evolving species, and to some degree, they have a lot of characteristics. It's about like dealing with a seven-year-old, and they have an attention span of a seven-year-old, and you have to do everything, there you have to do everything in first take.
Yeah.
And you have camera people who are very, very on the ball and ready to go when the orangutan starts doing something great. And even today, when I do movies with no animals, just actors, I always keep the set extremely quiet so
yeah.
I can go like this and get the camera rolling and the sound guy rolling, and they talk through radios a la Secret Service kind of thing,
rather than
shouting and yelling and all that crap.
Bouygues Télécom Entreprise présente les solutions business synchro.
Et dis donc, j'ai vu les bilans du trimestre. Excellent.
Ah,
sacrées économies sur le poste télécommunication. C'est la convergence ou t'as coupé le téléphone aux équipes?
Bah, c'est la convergence, évidemment. Maintenant, les appels sont illimités entre tous les postes fixes et les mobiles de l'agence.
Super impressionnant.
Avec les solutions business synchro, non seulement on est plus efficace au quotidien, mais en plus, j'ai plus qu'une seule facture à gérer pour l'ensemble de la flotte.
Avec les solutions business synchro, Bouygues Télécom Entreprise fait de la convergence fixe mobile internet une business réalité. Et c'est chez Bouygues Télécom Entreprise. De France, le gaz naturel devient une énergie créative. Associée aux énergies renouvelables comme le vent, le bois, le solaire ou la géothermie, le gaz naturel se fait créateur de solutions énergétiques innovantes, économiques et durables. Gaz de France, une énergie nouvelle entre nous.
Comment dire ? Madame J est un être vivant. Elle vit en France. Quand elle a un rhume, elle prend des médicaments. Et après, ça va mieux. En France, les médicaments sont remboursés ou ne le sont pas. Les médicaments non remboursés sont de plus en plus chers et de plus en plus nombreux. Ça tombe mal pour Madame J et son budget. Leclerc demande que ses docteurs en pharmacie puissent vendre les médicaments non remboursés à prix Leclerc.
Aujourd'hui, le plastique se recycle aussi en stylo. En stylo Bigreen de Pilote. Bigreen, la première gamme de stylos en plastique recyclé. Pensez à l'environnement, écrivez Bigreen.
Côté sexe, vous êtes plutôt du genre bête sauvage ou grand timide? Découvrez vite votre logo avec votre Astro Sexe. Envoyez Astro au 83839. Astro au 83839.
Eh, hey, dis donc, le groom, t'es bloqué ou quoi?
Non.
Eh, hey, bon alors, tu te bouges?
Non. Je propose qu'on se bouge tous ensemble.
Prêt pour le grand saut dans la tour de la terreur? Rendez-vous à Disneyland Paris.
Si vous recevez des cadeaux aussi vite, c'est parce que votre carte de fidélité vous permet de cumuler des smiles chez 9 partenaires. Avec Smiles, recevez vos cadeaux 9 fois plus vite.
Smiles.
Pourcentage de cacao pour créer excellence de Lindt. Il faut les meilleures fèves. Le secret d'une recette unique, des heures et des heures de conchage et l'expérience des maîtres chocolatiers Lindt. Découvrez la symphonie de plus de 400 arômes dans son infinie finesse.
Excellence de Lindt, découvrez la différence.
Who directed the fourth Dirty Harry movie, Sudden Impact?
Who did that one?
You
oh,
did.
I did that. Yes. Yeah. I did. Yes. Yeah.
This was the darkest of the films with a very ambiguous ending. How much responsibility did you have for the story and the screenplay?
When he says, go ahead and make my day, I realized that that was going to be the key word out of the picture.
Did you know it?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you knew that. If you're going to point a gun to somebody and tell them, go ahead and make my day. I mean, right away you knew, yeah, the audience was going to go for this.
Go ahead. Make my day.
When you did Pale Rider, you returned to the Western form. And I would like to ask you now what appears to be, at least on the surface, a kind of pattern. In A Fistful of Dollars, you were described by Richard Corliss as a Christ figure. In Hang 'Em High, you were lynched and then resurrected to fight against lynch law. In High Plains Drifter, the screenplay hints that you're an avenging angel. In Pale Rider, you're called the preacher. Why are you so drawn to the mystical and the supernatural? Is it a creative or religious conviction, or both, or neither, or none of my business?
I don't know. I think because I left the ending of High Plains Drifter in such an ambiguous way, that maybe in Pale Rider I decided that maybe I should just make him an out-and-out apparition.
I think Pale Rider took you to Cannes, didn't it? You went to the Cannes Film Festival.
Yeah, I did. I enjoyed going there because we took a Western there. Nobody ever takes Westerns there, so it was kind of fun, and it was received rather well.
When you were there that time, weren't you knighted by the French?
Well, they give you a thing called the Chevalier of Arts and Letters. And
that's a knighthood.
And then later on they gave me the Commander of Arts.
Well, you're a Commander of the Arts.
I'm a Commander. So watch your step.
I'm only a chevalier.
A chevalier, though, that's okay.
Well, no, I have to. I think I have to salute you or kiss your ring
for the club. We have a handshake or something.
Do we?
No, I don't.
They didn't tell me.
all I did is give you a kiss. I remember the guy gives you a kiss on both cheeks.
You know who gave me my kiss? Was Andor Nanot, the Countess d'Ornano
of
the Deauville Film Festival, where you have gone.
Her.
You've gone to the Deauville Film Festival, haven't you? It's a great
I've been to Deauville, and I've met her on many occasions. Mine was Jack...
Jacques Long?
No, Jack Long.
I got kissed by a woman.
Yeah, you were lucky. Some guys...
But you're a commander.
Some guys, you'll do anything to be a commander.
See what happens when a couple of knights get together?
Knowing what we do, I suspect that for you, Bird was a dream come true. Bird is a dream come true. What a movie.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Who is the bird of the title?
Jolly Parker.
And when did you encounter his music?
I went to a jazz at the Philharmonic in Oakland. This guy comes out, and he's got a pinstripe suit, and he's standing off to one side, and all these people are playing. And the joint's kind of jumping, you know. And then this guy steps up and starts playing, and everything is doubled up. And I'm just thinking, how the hell does he do that? And how does he come out where he does at the end? So I just kind of got fascinated by it. And also, it was a great acting lesson, because the amount of confidence that he exuded, I've never seen an artist have that kind of confidence. Standing there, actor, painter, anything. And then I heard they had a script over at Columbia about Charlie Parker. And so I went over and I read the script and I really liked it. So I talked Warner Brothers into trading off another piece of material to Columbia. It wasn't a commercial project. It wasn't intended to be commercial. It was just intended to be this movie about the life, and it was taken from Chan Parker's My Life in B-flat.
One of the ways you can discern the quality of a director is from the performances that the director consistently gets from his or her actors. I would submit that Clint gets great performances in picture after picture after picture.
Telegram to Mrs. Chan Parker, 151 Avenue B, New York City. Chan, comma, help. Yet. Parker.
The film is dedicated, is it not, to musicians everywhere?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, who was your director of photography on that? You had a new one on this one.
Jack Green was on that one, who was an operator for Bruce.
Jack Green has said, Clint doesn't say action or cut. He says, okay, let's start now. And, okay, that'll be enough. Which distinguishes you from nearly every other film director on this planet. Now, that has to be a conscious decision on your part. Why do you do it?
It started out in the Westerns. You'd ride in four horses. You got a camera here, and you got four riders, and they're supposed to all be side by side. That's very difficult to get into a fairly close shot. And then right away, they come out, and they zing a boom, a mic boom out there. The horses don't like that. So they're getting edgy in that. And then just when you start and you got the four horses up there, they're gonna come riding into shot. Some guy yells at the top of the lung through a megaphone, action! Well, these horses go every which way, and I'm on them. And they're bouncing this way and that way. And when you get them in the scene, they're just backing them out. The directors are going, cutting them. Why the hell can't these damn horses do? And you just say, how about just not saying action? How about saying something else? I said, say something, say anything, you know, and so I never could get him to do it. But to just yell action and stop the actors, it came to my attention that actors are not like horses, but they do have a central nervous system. And they're sitting there with a certain amount of anxiety about the scene, depending on their experience level. But they have a certain kind of approach they're ready to
I believe in the nearly 10 years of this series, The word masterpiece has been uttered twice. Tonight, I think it can be employed a third time in reference, of course, to Unforgiven. What is the genesis of this film?
Well, it was submitted to my company at Warner Brothers some years ago, many years ago, actually in 1980, I think. It was submitted to Sonia Chernus, and she wrote a scathing notice on the script. She said it was just barbaric, terrible thing. It would be awful. And so that was put in the file. Meanwhile, another person told me about this writer, David Peoples, and he's written some interesting things. I'll give you this Western. So the Western was called the William Money Killings. And I said, gee, this is an interesting script, but I said, it's not available. It was just being given to me as reference because Francis Coppola was going to make the film. Mm-hmm. So I called up the agent who represented David Peoples, and I said, I really like this screenplay, and I would like to employ this guy. And he said, well, you could buy the screenplay. And I said, no, I know all about Francis Coppola having it. He said, no, that expired yesterday. And I said, no kidding. I said, well, what's the deal on it? So he told me the deal, and I said, I'll take that deal. My plan was that somewhere, I just felt that the guy needed a little bit more age on him than it was at that particular time. In 1991, I brought it out and dusted it off and started the prep on it. I felt maybe it was a kind of a risky project, but I said I loved it and I wanted to do it. And that's all that those last two sentences are the right. The keys for my...
You've said I felt elements of myself in Will Money. What elements of yourself?
The presentation of him is so anti-Western. He's a pig farmer out there with his kids, and the ruffians are all scruffy looking. Mm-hmm. He's scruffy looking, and he's destitute.
Can't get on his horse.
Yeah, the guy comes along and talks him into his reputation in the past of being a renegade. He talks him into sort of coming back out of it, and he's in desperation. He decides to do it, and of course he starts to mount his horse. He hasn't ridden in a while. He can't get on it. I thought, that's interesting. Why would a guy write that? What goes into a writer's imagination that you would think of that approach to the Western hero?
You take care of your sister now, my son. And you kill a few chickens if you have to, and keep those hogs that got the fever separate. If you have any problem, you go see Sally Two Trees at Ned Logan's.
The guy was totally tormented by his past and trying to reconcile it and channeling it all through this memory of the deceased wife.
Would you like a free one?
No, I guess not.
I didn't mean with me. I meant, Allison Silky would be happy to give you a free one if you wanted one. That's all I meant.
Oh, I didn't mean I didn't want a free one on account of you being cut up and all. And what I said the other day about you looking like me, that ain't true. You ain't ugly like me. It's just that we both have got scars. You're a beautiful woman, and if I was to want a free one, I'd want it with you, I guess, more than them other two. Just that I can't on account of my wife.
There were so many oddities to it, and I thought this could make a really good Western. I don't know if anybody'd like it, but I would like it, so that's... Oof.
There seems to be a strong strain of feminism in several of your movies. It's certainly evident in Unforgiven, where the whores get together, pool their money to avenge their brutalized sister.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that the women were treated terribly. And they have to figure out something to get justice.
Yes.
And it just shows these fate-driven stories, and I've been involved with a few of them, that there's the train is on the track and there's nothing you can do to stop it. And fate is leading its way towards the end of it. And you know that they set off by sending out a bounty on this thing. They set off a chain of events that are unstoppable.
The casting of that film is impeccable. When Gene Hackman was our 100th guest in this series, we talked at length about the film, about you. I understand he was very reluctant to play that role at first. But you changed his mind, right?
Yeah, I did. He was in a kick then in his life. He said he didn't want to do anything with violence in it. And I said, Gene, I know where you're coming from, and I know I've got kids and everything, and I'm getting sick of violent films that are overly violent. And the fact that you're playing a character that is not just the black hat villain that comes in and is snarling at everybody, you're a decent guy. I mean, you have strong beliefs. You believe in gun control. You believe, especially if you're controlling it. But anyway, he believes in controlling his town, his domain, and Francis's role takes sort of the lead in setting up this bounty they put out, and they send out the word, and all these strange characters get together.
Yes. Shall we pause for one brief second? I would like to acknowledge a distinguished member of the Actors Studio, the person to whom Clint has just referred, Francis. Shall we do a stand up, please? Gene spoke to us with great enthusiasm about being directed by you and working with you, acting with you. Tell us about the experience of working with Gene Hackman.
Gene, once he decided he liked the character and came aboard, he's an intense worker and just totally professional.
It seems obvious to me that almost every film you make has a purpose beyond its surface purpose. Unforgiven seems to be a kind of meditation. What do you think Unforgiven says to us?
The protagonist, which I played, was a man who had had a terrible past as far as being a renegade and a murderer. And he wasn't just a noble guy in a white hat riding in saying, "Where's the school, Mom?" You know?
You've described the lighting of Unforgiven as being inspired in part by Carol Reed's The Third Man. You described it as being only partial, the faces are only partially seen. Yeah. You see streaks of light on faces. And with regard to that, you said something very interesting. Audiences are very smart. They don't have to see everything. If one were to look for a guiding central principle as actor and director, it would seem to be at least in part that. Is it a fair assumption? Is that what, do you have faith in your audience?
Yeah, I do. I feel that if you're doing a whole film, you're gonna spend 2 hours watching it, you have to see the same set of eyes, the same looking out, the same lighting, the same flat look or every time. Or you can sometimes see, you know, Carol Reed did a wonderful thing in Third Man, is sometimes he just knew the lower face.
Yeah.
And the eyes were not visible at all.
Yes.
And it became very interesting as you saw the character when Orson Welles steps out. You don't see it, you get the feeling. The audience knows who it is because we've been talking about this character for an hour.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, so they read in things. You give them a chance to imagine with you. Give them a chance to participate in the film, not just voyeur it. And that I think is something that will make a film a little deeper for them.
Unforgiven received 9 Academy Award nominations and won 4. What was the Oscar experience like for you?
Well, it was good. You think back on time and you go back to the Rawhide days or early Leone days and you think, well, here you are all these years later and you're directing a film and now this film is from out of nowhere And Westerns are not supposed to win.
Yes.
So you take the work seriously, but don't take yourself seriously. And if you keep that in mind, you'll do well the rest of your life.
All right. Unforgiven was not only a eulogy for the old Western. It was a eulogy for a character whom you had drawn definitively. As Richard Schickel observed in his biography, when William Money vanished from the screen, he vanished from your work, replaced by a noticeably different and far more vulnerable man. That is nowhere more evident than in a splendid film called The Bridges of Madison County. The problem with directing yourself is that when you get into the scene, you have to play with the other person, and the director has to stay somewhere out there in the darkness, oh, yeah. Right? Not so easy. Meryl, who was here with us, she said she only caught you directing as you were acting once, and that was during one of the love scenes when she realized that behind her back, you were gesturing to the camera.
Well, it is difficult directing, not with Meryl, you know, necessarily. But I mean, she's a very a wonderful woman. But it is difficult to direct yourself for that reason, as you never quite get the objectivity that you would. So you have to be able to trip the switch back and forth. And it's something you learn over the years. And sometimes you have to. In the early days when I was first directing, I had to. Sometimes say, wait a second, okay, now I know what this person's doing. Now I got to cover myself. What do I do? And Don Siegel gave me advice. He said, don't short yourself. Take your time, and complete every sequence. So finally, you get so you can throw the switch and you can act within the scene, and then you can pull yourself out of it. Meryl Streep has done a lot of pictures where she would do a lot of rehearsal, but with me, she was, I just started shooting everything right away, and she just fell in love with that idea. She thought it was great.
She spoke about it here.
And finally, she was saying, can't we shoot the rehearsal? And I said, absolutely. Why not? Because you never know. You hate to miss shooting something, and some brilliant moment come that you may try 100 times again, and it never comes out quite the same.
One of my favorite Clint Eastwood scenes is in this movie. Meryl talked about it. She said, it's a scene in which, toward the end, you break down. And she said that when the scene was over, she reproved you and said, why on earth did you turn away at that moment? That's the scene actors pray for. That's the Oscar nomination scene.
I just felt that that sometimes what you don't see is more important than what you do see. And if you just flash yourself in the camera and you're sitting there going, oh, Jesus Christ. Anybody can do that. I mean, most actors can think of that, and they say, geez, what did I think of? Okay. I remember when my dog was run over when I was 7 years old. And so you
that
sit
famous
there,
dog.
And you go, and you start crying, and you start thinking about the dog, and the tears come running out of your face. But you think, but is that really doing anything? What is that doing? And besides, it was her dilemma, but it was his dilemma. And if you have both people with the exact same temperature of their dilemma, I just felt it was better to feature her in it.
I think it's a fine scene for both. Who wrote Doe Eyes, the song we hear on the track?
I did.
Why is it called Doe Eyes?
Well, because it's sort of after a doe. Does always have beautiful eyes. And the doe down here has good eyes, too.
Was it specifically written for a person?
Yeah.
Is it time to introduce the person?
Oh, I don't know. She might get terribly embarrassed.
I think it's time for you to meet Dina Eastwood and her doe eyes, please.
She's a dark, dark creature.
Is she?
No, I mean, she has doe eyes, and so...
Nice. What made you run for mayor of Carmel?
Vengeance. I
against?
It was the city council. I lived in a small town, Carmel, California. It was 4,000 people and change, and but the city council I felt was being very punitive to the constituency out there. So I felt that somebody should do something about that. So I tried to back people. I said, "Come on, we got to run. We got to get some new blood. We got to get." Everybody kept saying, well, who's going to do it? Who's going to do it? Nobody was stepping up. So finally one night, we were all sitting around, and we had a glass of wine. And this guy says, come on, Clay. He says, you run, we'll bust this town wide open. I said, well, I don't know about busting it open, but the mayor, it happens to be a two-year term as opposed to a four-year term for council members. So I said, okay, I'll run for mayor. So I ran for mayor. I thought that nobody would ever notice it because it's such a small town and everything, but it kind of became, it kind of got bigger than it should have, let's put it that way.
Did you enjoy it?
Yeah, I did. I enjoyed it.
3 days ago, I was privileged to see a film called Mystic River. Like so many of your films, it defies easy definition. It's the story of three friends who share the memory of a terrible event. It's the story of a shocking crime. It's a police procedural that leads from one revelation to another. It's a remarkable ensemble piece that interweaves intriguing, complex characters played by powerful actors at the peak of their powers, guided by a director at the peak of his. We all know that directing a movie requires an enormous commitment of time and energy. What appealed to you in Mystic River?
It was something about lost innocence, losing a life psychologically to child abuse, and how it affects a person all their life, and how it affects everybody. And as they grow up, and how it comes back to haunt them as these three men grow up and become 45-year-old people in society. Had a wonderful cast, headed by Sean Penn and Tim Robbins and Kevin Bacon and Lawrence Fishburne and Laura Linney and Marcia Gay Harden. Every one of them are just letter perfect.
Mr. Markham, you say you spend most of the day Saturday with your daughter in the store, is that correct?
Yes and no, I was mostly in the back.
Anything odd? A confrontation with a customer? Anything?
No, she was herself. She was happy.
She what?
It's nothing.
Listen, the littlest thing could be something right now.
It's just when she was little. Right after her mother died, I'd just gotten out of prison. She couldn't be by herself. You know, whether she was crying or not, it didn't matter, but she'd give you a look sometimes, like she was preparing to never see you again. A couple of seconds on Saturday, she looked at me that way.
Okay.
It's just a look.
It's information. We collect it, put it together, see what fits. Little things. You say you were in prison?
Jesus.
Here we go. Buddy.
I'm just asking.
16 years ago, I did a 2-year bid for robbery at Deer Island. Is that going to help you find my daughter's killer? I mean, I'm just asking. Let's forget about that. Let's go.
I had the actors, they rehearsed on their own a lot. They didn't rehearse, but they read a lot. They would have readings at night. They'd sit up and read it. When a new actor would come to town that was joining the cast, they'd sit and read the whole thing all over again and add the new character.
Yeah.
So it was terrific. I mean, I encouraged it because they love the material, and they love the words. And when you have a piece of material where everybody loves what they're doing and the words come out, it's a kind of script where you don't have to change anything.
I mean, all those years ago, when you were a little boy, Dave.
Dave's dead. I don't know who came out of that cell, but it sure as shit wasn't Dave. You see, honey, look, it's like vampires. Once it's in you, it stays.
Where is Mystic River?
It's in Boston.
And I understand you insisted on shooting in Boston.
The author is from Boston. We used the Boston Symphony and the Tanglewood Chorus. We did everything in Boston. Interiors, exteriors, scoring, you name it.
Who was your director of photography this time?
It was Tom Stern, who was a gaffer for Jack Green and for Bruce Surtees for many years. He'd been with me for many years.
You're very loyal to the people who work for you.
When they're good people and they're loyal to you, there's no reason not to be loyal back. And selfishly, they're people that do the kind of work I like, and they understand my language. I'm not a terribly talkative person, unless I've had a couple of beers, but I kind of make gestures, you know, this is for that, and we can do it. And that's the way I keep the set. And when people say they're gonna shoot, I say, okay, let's do this. The assistant director doesn't yell quiet everyone and all that stuff. He just yells, we're shooting, you know, and I go. And that it goes through. And somebody in the back room goes, we're shooting. So everybody stands still. When I go on to other sets and I hear all this noise, I go, oh my God, this would be a nightmare. I couldn't stand it. But I think I got onto it by working with kids and working with new people and stuff. If you just can keep that atmosphere that's really nice and tranquil and give people the best possible atmosphere to work in, you have to be like a musician. You have to be able to play with what's going on.
Yeah. Take improvising.
The moment, seize the moment.
Improvising.
Yeah, actors spend all their life doing improvisations. I knew in my early days, we used to improvise weeks and weeks and never play a scene. But it affords you a chance to grab some really wonderful moments in life that you normally wouldn't see.
Happy accidents.
Yeah.
When I was over at Warner's to see the screening of Mystic River, I was invited into the Al Paso office, and I spent a lot of time with the editor of the film, with Joel Cox.
Yeah.
I went into your editing room there. It's just steps from your office. Are you in the edit room with your editor normally in post-production?
Yeah. Nowadays you can edit anywhere, because what we do is put the Avid computer in the back of a small truck and bring it to wherever you are. So I'll edit in Carmel a lot of times.
Who wrote the score of Mystic River?
I did.
When you're writing, do you compose on the piano?
Yeah. I just kind of started thinking about the trilogy of the three fellas. And so I just picked out a triad on the piano and I just started working that triad. And then I went over to a friend of mine who has a synthesized computer with all kinds of fancy equipment to it, and I played it into his computer. And then he started playing artificial elbows and artificial strings, and we sort of mocked up the whole score.
Jesus.
So I had the whole score for the rough cut, and then I went back and had the Boston Symphony finish it off, which was really fun.
In the final scenes of the film, it confronts head-on the important moral questions that the movie has been asking every minute of its length. As you often do, you leave one question open to be answered not by you, but by the public. Is this an instance of your trust to the moviegoer?
Yeah. I think the moviegoer knows the answer.
Damn. I just want to hug him. Look.
We begin each classroom with the questionnaire invented by Marcel Proust and brought to perfection by my hero, Bernard Pivot. Clint, what is your favorite word?
I use tranquilo a lot, because when things are getting kind of hectic around, I use it. I also use vermischt a lot.
Which is?
It means sort of harried.
Harried. What is your least favorite word?
Ubiquitous.
Ubiquitous?
Yeah. I guess it's just too in. I don't like to be in. When it's in, I want to be out.
What turns you on?
I think I'm turned on by people who have a great sense of humor.
What turns you off?
Just cliche.
What is your favorite sound?
A trumpet.
What is your least favorite sound?
I've never been a real rock guy. I'll tell you why. I went through the whole 60s and 70s, and I never really kind of got into it because it always seemed, if I wanted to hear that three chord change music, I'd much rather listen to rhythm and blues. It's a black person's art. I mean, it was invented by the blues players and the people who came up out of the South, and it's those people. But when you hear the spin-offs, the sort of patty version of it all, it just doesn't work for me. I have to kind of go for the real thing on it.
What is your favorite curse word?
Jamf.
What?
It's J-A-M-F. Jamf.
Is it an acronym? Is it
Jive Ass Mofo.
You can say it.
It used to be Red Fox and Scatman Crothers. They used to use it all the time. It's a jive-ass Mo Fletcher, baby. And don't you forget it.
Okay. What occupation other than yours would you like to undertake?
If you go back and say, geez, if I'd only studied, you know, if I practice, and you play in Carnegie Hall. Well, I was lucky enough to play in Carnegie Hall, and I never practice.
What occupation would you absolutely not like to participate in?
I would say politics, but I've already done that. I think I would say that I wouldn't want to go any further with it.
Okay. Finally, if heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
Welcome, and you're going to stay up here forever and go nowhere else. And you've got 72 virgins all waiting for you.
Hi, my name is Gina Mamer, and I'd like to know, when you start looking at a script for a new role, how you approach the work.
Well, first place, I look at the screenplay and try to just get as much understanding as I can about what the writer is intending and what the accomplishment is, what it's going to take to accomplish this thing, and then how do I fit in? Then I kind of look through it and see, and then what can I bring to it that's different? I've never thought of acting as really a intellectual art form. It, to me, it is a very organic sort of art form, and the best actors are people who can seem to bring it up from inside, and the more you think about it, the worse it becomes. We talked about a little bit earlier, just being, and so then how am I in this just being a person, a real person, and then how do I make this ensemble better? You know, so it isn't just a one, isn't just what's good for me, it's what's good for the, how good the scene is depends on everybody in it.
Ron Brosh, I'm a working actor here in L.A. Talking about listening and silence and using words very sparingly, that to me was the first illumination of the Clint Eastwood brand of character, which is very unique, very signature. How important do you believe it is for an actor to kind of hone in on what their unique signature is?
I don't know how you'd come about discovering what is really right for you, but when I'm at listening, and I hate to get into this thing where everybody thinks they got to take a moment with every little thing that's uttered. There was a period in the 50s when everybody was doing that. Everybody was thinking and pondering. But if you look at a picture like His Girl Friday, and you watch Rosalind Russell, and Cary Grant, and you see two people who are talking intensely, right at all on top of one another, but they're still listening. I mean, they're not. You never catch them anticipating the other person's cues, and so their technique is so honed down that they can talk a million miles an hour, and still make it seem like a functioning deal. if you listen to, you watch Crossfire and stuff like on TV, nobody's listening to anything. They're just kind of, everybody's interrupting. It's just transmitting, just transmit, and no receiver. But you can do it fast. Watch His Girl Friday. And Howard Hawks at his best. It's up to you as young actors to bring all that, not be afraid to bring all that in to play.
Thank you.
Since the questions have had a certain nature, I thought you might like to meet a legendary agent. That would be Mr. Lenny Hirshan. Would you stand up for a moment, please, Lenny? How long have you been associated with Clint?
40 years.
I was a young 5-year-old actor.
I needed a 6-year-old agent.
How did you two become involved?
We're not involved. Give me a complex.
That's for Dina's sake. Go on.
We got involved during the Italian Westerns, the Spaghetti Westerns, and all the pictures since then. So listening to everything tonight is like seeing my own life flash in front of me. But I think we should mention something else, Jim, about the fact that I started in New York and I was casting a lot of television, and I used to call a young actor in New York for various jobs on television, and his name was James Lipton.
I want it on the record, but Clint Eastwood and I have the same age.
Hello, Mr. Eastwood. My name is Sky Soleil. I was wondering if Clint Eastwood has ever been scared or intimidated by a piece.
Afraid of nothing. Hey, It's just all cumulative. It's a lifetime of doing certain things, and you become confident about certain things, and you have a certain confidence. It's like an electrician who comes in, has been doing it for many years, has a lot more confidence in handling electrical things because it's his deal, and you can do it almost with his eyes closed. One thing about acting and directing, you're a constant student, and I think that's the reason I'm still doing it at this stage in my life, is you're just a constant student. And every film you learn something. Every project you learn something new. You learn something new about people, you learn something new about actors, acting, about directing, and that's what makes it exciting. That's why I'm still doing it. And that's the great part of being an actor, is that it's a never-ending process. And you can be 90 or 20, and you're still learning. I mean, naturally at 90 you've probably unfortunately forgotten a lot of things, but it's great. That's the fun of it all. It's great fun, and you're really lucky when you can make a living and manage to exist in a profession that's fun.